Well, if you've been with us the last months, we're actually going on almost a year of studying Song of Solomon. And guess what? Today is the end of the Song of Solomon series. So we have made it, and I hope that you have learned a lot about the love of God for people. In fact, not next week, because I'll be gone next week, but the week after, we're going to start into the book of Daniel. We're going to work our way through that, which is going to give us a lot more insight and context into the book of Revelation, which is what we've been studying in our evening service. So, but today, if you would open your Bibles to Song of Solomon chapter 8, we're going to work through this passage fairly quickly. In your bulletin, you have a handout that I want you to use for referencing and going deeper into things. I'm not going to cover everything that's in there, but there's some key points that I want to go over with you. The first four verses in chapter 8, you don't have in the notes, so I just want to give you a really short synopsis of what's going on in these verses, because it's all still hanging together to the previous section of looking how the bride has been maturing in love and how she has been learning how the love that with which the king loves her actually fuels her ministry, and she has a passion to minister to the church. And so as we get into chapter 8 here, I'm going to go ahead and read through the whole chapter and then talk about the different verses. So, chapter 8, Song of Solomon. Oh, that you were like a brother to me who nursed at my mother's breasts. If I found you outdoors, I would kiss you. No one would despise me either. I would lead you and bring you into the house of my mother who used to instruct me. I would give you spiced wine to drink from the juice of my pomegranates. Let his left hand be under my head, and his right hand embrace me. I want you to swear, O daughters of Jerusalem, do not arouse or awaken my love until she pleases. Who is this coming up from the wilderness, leaning on her beloved? Beneath the apple tree I awakened you. There your mother was in labor with you. There she was in labor and gave you birth. Put me like a seal over your heart, like a seal on your arm. For love is as strong as death. Jealousy is as severe as Sheol. Its flashes are flashes of fire, the very flame of the Lord. Many waters cannot quench love, nor will rivers overflow it. If a man were to give all the riches of his house for love, it would be utterly despised. We have a little sister, and she has no breasts. What shall we do for our sister on the day when she is spoken for? If she is a wall, we shall build on her a battlement of silver. But if she is a door, we shall barricade her with planks of cedar. I was a wall, and my breasts were like towers. Then I became in his eyes as one who finds peace. Solomon had a vineyard at Baal Hamon. He entrusted the vineyard to caretakers. Each one was to bring 1,000 shekels of silver for its fruit. My very own vineyard is at my disposal. 1,000 shekels are for you, Solomon, and 200 are for those who take care of its fruit. O you who sit in the gardens, my companions are listening for your voice. Let me hear it. Hurry, my beloved, and be like a gazelle or a young stag on the mountains of spices. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray that you would open our understanding this morning to be able to see your truth declared to us and applied to us in your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this passage starts off giving some background information about how God interacts with his people. What has happened in the bride's life at this point is she has developed such a love for the Lord that she refuses to be ashamed of that display of love. See, in these first few verses, what happens is in that culture where the bride, where this whole thing is taking place, in that culture, it was more okay for you to show affection to your brother than it was to your husband. It was considered normal and good to have displays of affection within your family, But there was a very much a private view of affection when it came to the marital relationship. You even have that today in Middle Eastern cultures. In fact, Jerry was mentioning a trip to Israel possibly next year. So in Middle Eastern culture, the husband-wife relationship is displayed very, very differently than what we are familiar with. You don't hold hands in public. In fact, some cultures, the husband walks a few feet in front of the wife. And so it's a very, very different thing. What she's saying here is, I wish you were like a brother so that I could openly show my affection for you in the public place. She's like, I would bring you into my mother's house just like I bring my brother in there, and I could show you the affection that I have in my heart for you, Jesus. And it goes on, and she has a desire. She speaks and says, let his left hand be under my head and his right hand embrace me. The hands of God, they portray different things in Scripture. We know the right hand is his hand that is extended to us in his power, and he interacts powerfully through his right hand. It's a place of authority. The left hand is the things that the Lord does that aren't obvious to us, moving behind the scene. So she even says, I want his left hand behind my head. If you embrace someone, you have a hand behind the head, you can't see what's happening there, but it is actually protecting you. You know, we prayed for a few different things this morning. One that's on my heart is we're going to be driving a good distance this week to Colorado. You know, there's a lot of things that could go wrong. I want the Lord to go before us and prepare the way and protect us and send his angels to guard us as we drive. That is the left hand of the Lord. It's out of view. We don't see everything that he does, right? We never will see everything that he does. But we know he is there protecting us. And then his right hand is more visible to us. We see his power. Like we sung this morning about, we can feel the love of God in this place. And that was actually true this morning. I can feel the love of God and his presence in our congregation this morning. And that is wonderful. So there's different times we see him interacting with us directly. You've heard the praise reports this morning. That's him reacting directly to prayer requests that we have brought up to him. So it's really awesome to see, but there's a lot that happens behind the scenes. So we're going to pick up with verse 5, where we're going to study in some more detail. Paragraph A in your handout says, the bride is described as coming up out of the wilderness, leaning upon Jesus as her beloved. The wilderness is a place that nobody wants to be, but everybody goes through. Everybody goes through the wilderness. This is temptation. This is trial. This is testing. There's different seasons in your life. If you've been alive for any amount of time, you know there are seasons in your life where you go through a wilderness experience. Everything seems dry and hot and dead, right? And you're like, why is this happening to me? What is going on? And we've seen the bride in her story so far. She has gone through different seasons in her life that have shown wilderness times very clearly. I want you to understand something. I'm going to write this down for you. I just noticed somebody stole my pens. Somebody grabbed me a marker. I think I've got some on my desk. Or somebody else. Okay. Oh, hey, here they are. Thank you. When you go through wilderness, there's two reactions that you can have. This reaction that I'm writing on here is what the Lord wants you to have. The Lord wants you to have a vision for victory. A vision for victory. What he says here in Song of Solomon is, who is this coming up from the wilderness leaning on her beloved? See, when we go through times of testing and trial, what the Lord wants to do in those times is to develop in us a trust for Him. A recognition that He is the one that we can lean on to make it out of the wilderness. A vision in your life for being victorious over all the struggles that you deal with in your life. I know we men, we have common struggles that at different times in our life, they rear its ugly head, right? I mean, a lot of us guys struggle with anger. A lot struggle with pornography. A lot struggle with how to relate towards women in a right way. And so these struggles are part of our wilderness experience. And the question is, what vision do you have for victory over those areas? A lot of us walk through life and we're like, oh, I'm never going to get out of this. This is just my besetting sin. Yay, it's my little pet that I bring with me. And occasionally I'll send it away to go do its doo-doo somewhere else. And then it comes back. And we just live our life as though we're never going to have victory over these areas. And women, you're not immune to this either. Do you remember what happened in the garden? Do you remember why we're not in the garden anymore? In the garden, what happened? Your husband was standing right next to you at the tree, by the way. He was a little distracted by your body. Right? No clothes yet. And so the fruit is being offered by the serpent. And even though Eve had already been told not to do this, that this is rebellion and disobedience, she's like, you know what? I know better. Women, have you ever said that?
Amen.
I know better than what my husband says, or I know better than what God says in this case. And what is your vision for functioning the way that God has designed your life to be? What is your vision for victory? The vision needs to be leaning on her beloved. He reminds her that it was beneath the apple tree where she was awakened to this love. She was awakened in her understanding of how much the king desires her. And we've studied those passages, the first few chapters in the Song of Solomon. This coming up is personally being victorious in love, but it's also as the church being victorious in love. This is part of the journey of maturing in the faith. And when we start off in the faith, we are anything but mature, right? We try to even call sin okay because the Lord forgives me and His grace is applied towards it. Well, yes, His grace is applied to you. Yes, He forgives you when you repent, but that does not mean you stay in your sin. That does not mean that there is no way out of that wilderness. The way out is to lean on the beloved. In verse 6, he gives a way to do this. He explains this. It's a seal that he desires to place over our heart and a seal that he desires to have on our arm. A seal is something that in ancient times, if there was a letter or a decree that needed to be sent out from the king to his provinces, he would put his seal on there. There was wax. They would drip the wax onto the enclosed paper or parchment, and then he had a signet ring. In fact, I'm wearing a signet ring here. This is what one my mom gave me, and it has a little treble clef on there because I'm a musician, and she was passing on that gift to me. So I have a signet ring, and what would happen is that wax, before it dried, the ring would get imprinted into that wax to create the seal, and only the king had that seal. And he was the only one who could place that mark on there, and it was recognized in his whole kingdom. So what God is saying here to us, he's saying, I want you to place the seal of my love on your heart and on your arm. Now, your arm represents the ministry that you are involved with. the ministry that you do. Remember how we talked last week? How if we have a ministry that is fueled by the love of God, then it doesn't matter what people will do against you. Let me say that again. If you have a ministry that is fueled by the love of God, then it won't matter what people throw at you. Because your focus, your vision, is on the one who can take you out of the wilderness. Your sight is in the right place. We like to always just look down at our circumstances. Like, I don't see a way out. I have no idea how to get beyond where I am right now. Lord, it feels like this desert that I'm in is just so extensive, there's no way out. He's saying, no, if you allow me to place my seal of love on your heart, and the seal on your ministry that is a seal of love, there is nothing that can stop you. Here, take a look just briefly at Ephesians chapter 3. I always like to bring you back there because Ephesians is such a great book to place in your heart. And in chapter 3, it talks about, it's again a prayer of the Apostle Paul's. And he's praying that there would be something granted to us. And this has to do with that seal. Chapter 3 in Ephesians verse 16. That he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with power through his spirit in the inner man. So that Christ may dwell in your heart. It's that seal over your heart through faith. And that you being rooted and grounded in love may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to all the fullness of God. That is what the seal looks like. It is so extensive in your life that there is nothing that can stop you from getting out of the wilderness. What is your vision for victory? If it's not the seal of God's love, it won't work. Where are you at with vision for your life? Is your vision downcast? You're like, I can't see beyond where my feet will take me. And you need to learn to start leaning on your beloved. And let him be the one to direct you out of the wilderness. Put me like a seal over your heart. Like a seal on your arm. And then he says something interesting. He says, for love is as strong as death. Love is as strong as death. See, death claims everything. Everything that lives dies. In fact, Scripture says it is appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment, right? Well, everything dies. It's not even just man. Even the plants die, right? I can't keep a plant alive. In fact, I think I put most of the plants in the foyer there, and they're all dying, okay? So they die. Everything that's alive dies. Death is strong. It claims everything. I want to put a love so strong in my heart that it's just like death in the natural realm. It consumes everything. It takes care of everything. Death is a sure thing. God's love is a sure thing, but it has to be applied to my life. Love is as strong as death. Jealousy is as severe as Sheol, as strong as the grave, essentially, is what it's saying. It's a different way of saying the same thing. He goes on, he says, its flashes are flashes of fire, the very flame of the Lord. Many waters cannot quench love. I think it's amazing the analogy the Lord draws here. What happens if your house is on fire? What do?
Quench the water.
You call 911. If your house is, your towel's on fire, you get a jug of water from the sink, right? Your house is on fire, you call the fire department, and they come and they blow on it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. No. What do they do?
Water.
They douse it with water. In fact, interestingly, in a fire, most of the damage is not from the fire, it's from the water. Right? I don't know if you've ever known someone that their house has been through a fire, but most of the damage happens because the dousing of the water, even where the fire wasn't, things get completely drenched so that the fire doesn't go there. And so your house and your belongings and everything is destroyed by this water. Well, here's what he says. The fire of God cannot be quenched. Many waters cannot stop the fire of God. Now, waters in Scripture oftentimes talks about an overwhelming of bad things. Right? So when you're going through this wilderness and these trials and temptations and everything's going wrong in your life, the fire of God will burn as bright as it did before and cannot be quenched by anything that attacks you. It's what Ephesians just said when we read that. The width, the breadth, the height, the length. It surpasses our understanding. There's nothing that can stop it. Many waters cannot quench love, nor will rivers overflow it. And then there's a proverb, essentially, that is inserted here. And remember, the one who is writing this under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit is Solomon himself, and he wrote the book of Proverbs. So he's inserting a proverb here. He says, if a man were to give all the riches of his house for love, it would be utterly despised. And we sometimes think about that, and we're like, what does he mean here? What is this telling us? Think of it this way. I'll use an analogy. You have... All right, I'm gonna pick on JoJo. You didn't know I knew your name. Awesome. Okay, awesome. Now remind me of your little baby's name. Ronan. Okay, so Ronan. Let's just, as an analogy, let's say Ronan has a life-threatening disease. You own $1 million. You have this amazing property. And the doctors say, you know what, it's going to cost $15 million to save your baby. What would you do? You'd sell everything. Why? And you have nothing left. It's because of love, isn't it? It's because of love. And what he's saying here, if a man sold everything that he had for love, it would be utterly despised. And what that's saying is, someone would come to you and say, man, I don't know how you could possibly have given all of that stuff for your baby. I mean, you lost your $1 million, you lost your whole property, you lost everything that you have. And you would say, man, that's nothing. I've got my child. Don't even recognize me for what I did. It's nothing. I have my child. That's what it's saying. It would be utterly despised if it's given for love, because love is so strong. The love of God, the fire of God's love, cannot be quenched. And then they go into a passage, verses 8 through 12, that deals with a few different issues. I'm just going to quickly go through these with you. We have a little sister and she has no breast. What shall we do for our sister on the day when she is spoken for? If she is a wall, we shall build on her a battlement of silver. But if she is a door, we shall barricade her with planks of cedar. See, what's happening here is this is the passion that the bride has been developing in her ministry towards others from the household of faith. Her passion and her intercession for the church is in view here. Just as she has experienced this maturing and this growth in her life, and she's gone through the winds of testing and the winds of blessing, and she's seeing all these things, she's saying, as I'm investing in those that the Lord has given me to minister to, I want to make sure that they will stand firm and that they will learn how to lean on the Beloved as they go through the wilderness. So it's kind of a roadmap here that's being given. If she's a wall, we shall build on her a battlement of silver, just to reinforce that wall. But if she's a door, she's open to everything, right? And this is kind of what we're dealing with in Sunday school with the whole evolution versus creation. You know, if we as a church say, oh, sure, whatever, God used evolution, that's just opening a door. Because you're denying half of the scriptures by saying that. You're saying that God isn't all-powerful and couldn't just speak it into existence. You're saying that God's word isn't true. It's all supposed to be just an analogy. And sin didn't really happen. Adam and Eve weren't really people, the first people, and all that kind of stuff. And it's a never-ending revolving door of letting in compromise. And so what they're saying is, if the people that I am discipling, the people I'm investing in, if they're like a door, then I'm going to barricade her with planks of cedar. I'm going to enclose this door, barricade it shut so that nobody can get through that anymore. And that's sometimes what we need to do with people that are just really struggling with compromise. We just need to draw them in and say, man, just sit down for a minute and let me explain this to you. You need to shut that door, lock it, and throw the key away. Because that revolving door that you are, this compromise that you are constantly engaging in, is just going to destroy your faith. And it goes on in verse 10, she's focusing on her, and she's saying the bride's confidence, or the revelation of how God sees her, is what sustains her. I was a wall and my breasts were like towers. I had the ability to nurture others, and I didn't compromise. I stood with the will of God and was obedient to it. That's what this wall means. And I became in his eyes as one who finds peace. You see, in the wilderness, if you have a vision for victory, you will be able to walk through the wilderness in peace. That's an amazing concept. I mean, I don't know if you've ever been in the desert. I've been in the desert. I actually went to Israel when I was a teenager, and I ran. I thought I was being really, you know, cool and smart and everything, and there were some military guys with us on this tour that we were on, and we were going to Masada to see the ruins there and hear the history behind this castle that's built up on a mountain. And so I said, oh, well, I'm gonna run up the hill in the desert, because there were some other military guys who were like, you know, we'll run up here, it'll be fun. So I exhausted myself and I ran up there as fast as I could, and I beat all the military guys. And guess what? When I got to the top, I almost died. I had heat stroke. And all the military guys come trotting in there, and they're all fine. But I was dumb. I don't know where I was going with that. It was a fun story anyway. So, okay.
Rabbits.
Rabbits, indeed. Yes. So in verse 12, she says, my very own vineyard is at my disposal. The 1,000 shekels are for you, Solomon, and 200 are for those who take care of its fruit. She has everything that she has grown in and matured in belongs to the king. She had that transition at the end of chapter 4 where she recognized, I am not my own anymore. I belong to the king. And that's a recognition that every one of us goes through as we mature in the faith, realizing that we belong to Jesus and no one else. We have no claim on our own life anymore. I have some of my kids that are going to come up here, and they're going to sing the last two verses for us before I explain what these are about. They're profound verses of how the Lord desires for us to act in this world. So you can follow along in your Bibles, verse 13 and 14 of chapter 8.
Let me
So, you who dwell in the gardens, when Jesus speaks, he says, the place where I want you to live your life is in the place of ministry. The place where I want you to flourish in love for me is in the place of ministering to people, serving people. You dwell in the garden. The companions whom you're ministering to, they listen for your voice, which speaks of that authority that she has in the Spirit. And she has this credibility. Remember how in the previous chapter, Jesus actually allowed the bride to lead him to where they were going to go because of the confidence that was in her heart of following the Lord's plan. And then the person who says, let me hear it, is Jesus himself. He said, although the companions listen for your voice, I want to hear your voice. I want to hear your voice in worship as you sing to me. I want to hear your voice in intercession as you partner with me in prayer. I want to hear your voice in teaching as you're investing in other people, discipling them and teaching them the way to live. And I want to hear your voice in evangelism as you share the gospel with those who don't believe. And then there's this amazing last verse that echoes what we're told at the end of Revelation, where the Spirit and the Bride say, come. And Jesus responds, surely I am coming quickly. It says, hurry, my beloved, or make haste, my beloved. Be like a gazelle or a young stag. That animal has a characteristic of just bouncing over the hills, just running fast. You can't catch it so fast. In the mountains of spices, this is in scripture, refers oftentimes to the New Jerusalem. It's a call for the bride to partner with God's Spirit in asking for Jesus to come and to fix the mess that we're in. I don't know what the Lord has spoken to you this morning, but I just want to highlight this one more time. If you're going through the wilderness in your season of life right now, no matter what that looks like in your context, what is your vision for escaping it, for getting out of it, for getting through it? What is your vision? If it's not to lean on the beloved, if it's not to have victory in these areas, then you're going to stay in the wilderness. You're not going to find that joy. You're not going to find the fire of God's love to carry you through. Because essentially what you're doing is you're saying, I embrace the circumstances where I am, and I just can't be any better than this. That's not how God has designed you. He created you in His very image to have partnership and fellowship with Him, communion with Him. He desires for your life to be something He gave His own life for. He didn't just save us so that we could wallow in our circumstances. He saved us for greatness in His kingdom. To rule and reign with Him, it says in Scripture. To have victory. Now there's an old gospel song, Victory in Jesus. I don't know if you know that one, but that's what it's about. We have victory in Jesus over every circumstance. If you're in bondage to something, you can have victory in Jesus. And I want to invite you this morning, if there's anything that you're struggling with and you're just like, I just am sick of this. I want this to be gone out of my life. I want to invite you to just come to the altar this morning and ask Jesus to teach you how to lean on the beloved, to teach you how to have victory in this area. You are not designed to remain in that. You are designed to remain in Jesus.